So here we start. All right, so you got some music here, y'all. Oops.
Sailing away, set an open course for the virgin sea. Yes, I've got to be free, free to face life that's ahead.
All right, that was Styx, a band that was popular when I was a junior high and high school. And the song is Come Sail Away. And that's what we're going to be doing today. All right, folks. So what we're going to be looking at here, and I'm sorry there's so much writing on this slide and it's kind of small, and I hate to do that to people. This is one that I borrowed, but it has the main stuff you need to know. Really what we're looking at today is why Europeans were ready and able to start searching and exploring the, quote, new world. And then also some of the things that made that possible. Improvements in maritime technology. And tomorrow, talk about some economic reasons, some social reasons as well, too. The development of mercantilism and joint stock companies. And that's going to change not just Europe, y'all, but ultimately it'll help decide the economy that we have in America, even up to the present day. So it's very, very important. Now, the big idea is, of course, what drove European exploration and conquest? What makes the Europeans want to do this? Not just to explore, but to conquer that territory. And the simple answer is the three G's, gold, glory, and God, right? Those are the three things that will do it. And I'll even make that big so you guys can see it. You could write a whole book just on that as the reasons Europeans explored and conquered the New World, right? That's what I taught in seventh grade, that one long, miserable year. Anyway, so there you go. Gold, glory, and God. But it's really more than that, but that is a big, big thing. And you could organize a heck of an essay around that. This is the theme. It's America in the world, right? It's one of the AP themes. And so throughout the year, y'all, we'll be looking at the various economic, diplomatic, cultural things that are going to shape what is America or what becomes America. And as you guys will see, America will increasingly play a bigger role in the world. For a long time, y'all, we were focused purely on what becomes the United States. But over time, we'll start getting involved with other countries. And you guys know where that leads, right? To us having wars and stuff all over the world. We're, quote, the world's policeman and things like that. So you guys will kind of see how that gradually happens, okay? And so this is when America is going to kind of be introduced to the world. The learning objective from AP, and this is not in your notes or anything, but this is how they say it. They want you to get this out of the lesson today and tomorrow. Explain the causes of exploration and conquest of the new world. Give me the reasons for it and give me and for the conquest, okay? And we'll go through that in more detail. Now, I always bring up this group, y'all, the Vikings. My wife is of Scandinavian background from her family is Swedish and Finnish. And so she's obviously proud of her Viking background. Now, the Vikings, y'all, or Norsemen, people from the Northland, hence the term Norsemen from Scandinavia, these were the first documented people to come here, that we actually have physical proof of being here. You know, a lot of different nations claim that, oh, yeah, we sent people to America. Yeah, way before Columbus, yeah. There are the Irish, you know, there are the Chinese, you name them. But there is only proof of one other group before Columbus, and that is the Vikings. There you see them. You can even hear them. That's leaf size. And the song is Vinland. Okay, y'all. So the thing here is it's about 1,000 years ago that this happens. Now, the Norse explorers under a guy by the name of Leif Erikson was the first to come over here to what has become since known as Newfoundland. That's why I put PD. It has nothing to do with P. Diddy or Puff Daddy, if you guys even know who that is, because that's so long ago. But the way they did it, y'all, is over time, They basically started off over here in Scandinavia and made their way to Iceland, which I was lucky enough to get to visit y'all last year. It was awesome. It is such a cool place. And I don't mean that just literally. And then they made their way to Greenland, which was really not very green. I was supposed to go there this summer, y'all, but the trip got canceled to, you know what, Corona, right? And then they made their way up here into modern day Canada. And then finally they settled on an island that we since have called by the imaginative name Newfoundland. Of course, how did we get that name? A cartographer, a map maker said, what do you want me to call this newfound land over here? And they're like, that's it. Perfect answer. Newfoundland. And there we go. Now, they called the area, y'all, Vinland, or maybe pronounced it Vineland, because supposedly wild grapes were growing all over there. So they called it Vineland for vines, right? But it didn't go very well. Pretty soon, Native Americans attacked them, drove them away. We think maybe the Vikings started taking a fancy to the Indian women, and the Indian men weren't a liking, if you know what I mean. Now, the story basically had been forgotten, and people kind of came to believe, oh, this is just one of those stories that everybody tells about going over to North America before Columbus. But, and so it was in what we call the Norse sagas. But then, y'all, about the time Mr. D was born, no, not the 1860s, but the 1960s, they actually discovered the remains of Vineland. And here you see them unearthed today. You can visit them if you go to Newfoundland, which is a really cool island, by the way, kind of out of the way, but still kind of cool. Went there a couple of years ago. It was really neat. You can go and see the remains there. And they found tools. They found weapons. They found remains. And so guess what, y'all? The Vikings really did it. It's legit. Pretty cool, right? Okay. So what does this really have to do with it? Why does Mr. D spend the time on that? Because it's a really good example. Europeans, at least some of them, could get to North America, you know, by hopscotching across the ocean that way. But why didn't they? Why didn't more people follow up on this? Because for 500 years, y'all, basically nothing happens. Well, that's because Europe is not ready. And we're going to look at today the things that make Europe ready and able and interested to do it. For one thing, there's no printing presses. We're going to talk about that today to spread the story. The other thing is, these are going to be very, very expensive ventures, right? Going to America, y'all, was the equivalent today of going to space, going to the space station, or even going to the moon. Now, you guys know how dangerous and expensive that is, right? It takes a big country to do that. You don't see, like, you know, Guatemala sending people to space. You don't see, you know, like Burma or something sending people to space. It is just too doggone expensive to do that. And so there was really nobody to follow up on it. That is all about to change. So we're going to look at the things that get Europeans interested and ready at exploring here. All right. So one of the first things that's going to pique interest is a guy by the name of Marco Polo. Now, in history, we often divide things up or we label things as what I call Persians, right? Into political, economic, religious, social, intellectual, artistic, scientific. He kind of goes under artistic because he's really going to get people interested. Now, Marco Polo supposedly was a person from Venice, right? Future Italy. And he wrote a series of stories. These were published, as you'll see, the Gutenberg's Bible becomes, or Gutenberg's printing press becomes available to publish these stories. And these stories, y'all, they're absolutely amazing. Supposedly, he made his way here all the way from Venice, all the way through what we used to call the Middle East, Southwest Asia, to India, to Malaysia, all the way up into China today, and made his way back. And he had lived with the Khan. He had seen incredible riches. The stories he told y'all were amazing. And of course, people were like, holy cow, we got to see that. We got to get us some of that stuff. And what it reminds me of, y'all, one of my great interests in history is the moon race, going to the moon. And of course, that was an expensive deal. And eventually we tired out after only a few voyages and we have not yet returned. Now, in your lifetime, we will, because we have figured out ways that the moon is worth a lot of money and justifies the cost in doing so. But at the time, there really wasn't any. And I remember an astronaut saying once, you know, if we just brought along some gold dust and we just kind of sprinkled it on some of these moon rocks, we'd be coming to the moon forever as people tried to look for that gold. Marco Polo, his stories, y'all, were that gold dust. They got people interested in getting them to want to go. Ironically, we don't even know if this guy really existed, y'all. Many historians now doubt these stories. But, you know, in history, as you guys will find out, facts don't always matter. It's what people believe that matters. And if people act on what they believe, then the history part is irrelevant. He might not have existed. People believe he did. They believed his stories, and he inspired Europeans to want to make their way to Asia. Now, of course, the next things to talk about are the Crusades. Now, these go on, y'all, for a little over 200 years, quite a bit over 200 years, roughly between 1000 and 1300 AD. You see Europeans fighting a series of religious wars. What they're trying to do is get the Holy Land back from Islam, right? From Muslims who had taken over the land where Jesus and a lot of the Bible had taken place, right? Most of these were not very successful. Europeans lost more than they won. But yet, what happened over there, y'all, is going to have a direct impact on what happens here in America, right? So how is that? Well, one of the things that happens, y'all, is as these guys come back, they bring back some pretty cool things that they found. And think about it. I know this is going to sound awful, but, you know, when a guy goes off and you go on a trip somewhere, y'all, your friends, what do they say when you come back? Like, great trip. Did you bring me anything? And so the wives, the girlfriends, the mothers, the kids, they're like, hey, daddy, great. I'm glad you survived. What did you bring me back? Well, some of the cool stuff they brought back, y'all, were things like silk. Imagine when you live in a world where you're wearing wool. I don't know if you guys have ever worn wool. It is itchy and scratchy, and I'm not talking about in the Simpsons way. It is really, really painful to have to wear that stuff. Silk, y'all, man, that feels good. And to sound a little sexist, the ladies liked it, okay? Another thing that was very popular was perfume. Now, Europeans, y'all, did not tend to bathe very often. Now, this wasn't because they were dirty people or anything. It's because the water over there was awfully polluted. And people noticed pretty quickly, the people who bathed a lot were the people who got sick a lot and died a lot. So you tended not to bathe. So imagine, everybody pretty much smelled, y'all, like a locker room after a guy's football game, okay? But I guess if everybody smells that way, you don't really notice it. Well, the beauty of perfume, y'all, is what? It helps cover it up. Cover your body up and no one's going to know how bad you smell, or at least smells will be competing with each other. You had ivory to make some really cool carvings, right? For jewelry or household items and things like that from elephants. Fortunately, today we don't do that. There's all kinds of substitutes for it. Although sadly, many people still continue to hunt elephants and kill them, and it's just awful, y'all. But anyway, now the next thing are spices. Now, as I've gotten older, y'all, I've really discovered the spices. And here's a picture of the spices. There you go, right? Now, these, of course, are, well, let me let you just hear them.
If you want my future, forget my past. If you wanna get with me, better make it fast. Now don't go wasting
my precious time. Oh, sound ran off. Okay, there. Anyway, that's the spices, y'all. All actually named after real spices. That's my justification for showing that cool video, which your grandparents may have watched when they were children. But anyway, y'all, here's one of those cool spices. These are peppers, right? Peppercorns. You use these to get pepper. And of course, pepper makes food taste a little bit better. Now, you got to remember, y'all, this was a world where there were no refrigerators. There was very, very little ice, right? Except for a brief time during the year. Pretty much from the time you cook something, from the time you slaughtered an animal, it was rotting. And what these people ate and lived, y'all, would kill you and me like in seconds, right? And so they had to cover up the foulness of it. They had to do something to preserve it. Pepper was just one of the many spices. Cinnamon, here you see cinnamon, right? Also, nutmeg. Now, nutmeg, you guys have probably tasted when you eat pumpkin pie around Halloween time or Thanksgiving or whatever. It's very common. It also gives us mace, not what you use when somebody's chasing you, but you know that. And this also is cloves. Here you see cloves. I could not even think of the name of this during first period, y'all, but those are cloves. And as you guys get older, if you're not doing it yet, you're going to discover these things and use them in your cooking. And they're great, right? They just make food so much better. But they also helped preserve it. And they made it where people could eat it much longer, right? Now, there's also going to be inventions that will come up later. And these are going to be some things that they got from the Crusades. Now, the problem is, y'all, pretty much, pretty soon, all the spices, all the silk, all the perfume that the guys brought home were gone. And so what did the ladies, what did the kids all say? Hey, that was great. Do you have more? And they're like, no, like I got killed nearly bringing that back. Well, we need more or we're not going to be very happy. So after the Crusades, there's going to become this great demand by European men, women, children to get these products. And so a trade route is going to open up. Now that trade route, y'all, is going to be centered in Constantinople. That's right. Today, Constantinople is what is called Istanbul in modern day Turkey, right? So following the Crusades, this great trade network opens up between Europe over here, right? And Asia over here. And of course, it goes through an area that we used to call the Middle East. It was literally in the middle between the East and the West, right? Now, the center of that, if you look, y'all, look at how everything nearly converges right here. This is Constantinople, modern day Istanbul. It is the center of things. Well, in 1453, y'all, Muslims defeated the Byzantines who lived there, and much of the trade is cut off or it is made very, very expensive. Now, it was going to be very hard to get over here to get those things. And here you see a picture of what that might have looked like or a painting, right? Now, a new route is going to have to be found. Are the ladies? Well, let's just say it. The guy is going to be sleeping on the couch. They're not going to be very happy unless they start getting the things that they wanted. So we have to find a new way there. Ironically, that's going to lead to the discovery, quote, discovery, exploration, and conquest of the Americas. To go east, Europeans first went south, and then later they would try to go west to go east. Now, the next cause here is going to be a religious cause, y'all, and it's the Protestant Reformation. Y'all go, Mr. D, that ain't how you say it. Well, that is how you used to say it, because the root word in Protestant is protest. These were a group of people in Europe that eventually led a Reformation to reform the Catholic Church. Ultimately, they created multiple religions. Today, we have this general religion called Christianity. You have the Catholic religion is a big chunk of it. You have the Protestant faith, which has a bunch of different subgroups, whether you're Lutheran or you're Episcopalian, Presbyterian or Baptist or whatever, you fit under the Protestant group because your ancestors way back in the day decided, hey, the Catholic Church ain't for me. It's got some stuff going on that they didn't like, and they separated. Then you also have an Orthodox faith as well, too, that's centered more towards Greece and in Eastern Europe and that kind of thing, too. So there you go. So how does this all go about? Well, in the 16th and 17th centuries, you start seeing Reformation. And I apologize for part of the labeling being cut off there. So it begins there. Now, perhaps the most famous person in it is Martin Luther. Uh-oh. Okay, wrong Martin Luther. Although not completely. This Martin Luther King, okay, was named after the great Martin Luther, who leads the Protestant Reformation in Germany. Then we have John Calvin in Switzerland. He's going to have a big role on some of his ideas being part of what we call the Pilgrims or Puritans ideas. And then finally, we had Henry VIII in Britain. Oh, shoot. Y'all, I didn't mean to do that. That's a picture of Mr. Janus. I get them confused all the time. He looks so much like Henry VIII. I showed him this picture earlier today, and he said, man, that's cool. That picture back there, that's the ones that my students made last year. So hopefully you guys remember all that. But here's the real Henry VIII. And yeah, they do kind of look the same, don't you think? But anyway, here's Henry VIII in his later days when he was like, you know, multi-heavy. He had so many gross wounds on him, y'all, from illness. You could smell him before you see him. But that's another story. Now, here's a little song about Henry and his six wives.
I am Henry VIII, I am, I am. I got married to the widow next door. She's been married 7 times before, and everyone was an enemy. She wouldn't have a willy nor a son. I'm a rightful man.
That's his only son that he had. Edward.
Second verse, same as
six God. Wives. You don't need to know these. Catherine of Aragon, I'll talk about that. Anne Boleyn, who he had executed. Jane Seymour, who died giving him a baby. Anne of Cleves, who he divorced because of ugliness. Catherine Howard, who he had murdered. And finally, the wife who survived him. Now, his divorce, y'all, is going to lead to the formation of the English Church, or the Anglican Church, which plays a big, big role in early America today. Today, we don't call it the Church of England. If you live here in America and you go to the Episcopalian Church, it is the old Church of England. And if you're Catholic and you go to one of those, you might find it quite similar. And that's going to be a problem for some Europe or for some English people later on. So how does this happen? Why does he form a whole new church? Well, Henry, y'all, marries his dead brother's wife. I know, kind of gross, right? And she's not able to give him a son. She gives him a daughter, Mary Tudor, ultimately Bloody Mary. I don't know if you've ever played the game like late at night when you go into and look in the mirror and you scream Bloody Mary 3 times. But anyway, he has that daughter. Well, she can't give him a son. And being a typical guy at the time, he's like, well, no, it's not me. It's got to be my wife. I want a divorce. Problem, he's Catholic. Catholic Church doesn't give divorces, even though he's good buds with the Pope. Pope won't do it. So he's like, if you won't give me a divorce in your church, I'll form my own church. And guess what? I'll give myself a divorce. So that's how all it comes about. But pretty much, y'all, that early Anglican church is going to keep most of the Catholic stuff. And you're going to see a group of Englishmen and women who will call themselves the Puritans, and a group calling themselves the Separatists, who want to separate or purify themselves of all the Catholic stuff that's still left in Henry VIII's English church. Now, the believers, y'all, if you guys have ever met somebody who's discovered a new church or found a new religion, you know how they're super excited about it, and they want to tell you all about it, and they want you to come to it. Well, that's kind of how these people were. They have a new faith. They want to tell people about it. They want to find people and convert them to this new faith that is making them so happy and so fulfilled. At the same time, people that are Catholic and are remaining Catholic, they feel their religion, their world is under threat, and they want to also find converts. And what you're going to end up getting, y'all, is a terrible series of civil wars and stuff in Europe. Now, Catholic Spain, Portugal, and France particularly are going to try to find souls to save. And where are they going to find those souls, y'all? There's going to be plenty to find in the New World, except that's the Old World. But there you just see kind of what the two would look like. The two areas, you know, where the red is Catholic and the green is the Protestant areas. Okay, so religion's going to play a big role in them trying to take land, to convert the natives. Then we also have an intellectual thing that's going to lead to exploration. And that is something known as the Renaissance, or as we say in Texas, the Renaissance Festival. Now, between 1300 and about 1600, in the city of Florence, the birthplace of the Renaissance, you see an incredible birth or rebirth, which is where the word comes from, of classical learning. You have Greek books and Roman books, a lot of which have been saved by Muslim scholars who had written them down and preserved those, as well as some medieval scholars in monasteries. Well, these start being rediscovered, and people start getting kind of interested in learning again. It's not like they were stupid before, but they weren't that interested. Now, of course, you also have during this time, scientists and artists. I mean, they're the same thing in a lot of ways, y'all. And one of the greatest was this guy, Leonardo, right? There you see Leonardo. Oh, crap, that's the wrong Leonardo. That's Leonardo DiCaprio, not Leonardo da Vinci. Just happens sometimes, y'all. But anyway, here's the real Leonardo, not quite as an attractive guy. He came up, and I don't think Kate would save him. Instead of like, don't let go, it'd be like, let go. In fact, I'm pushing you off that board. But anyway, there you see the guy. And he came up with all kinds of cool inventions, most of which we couldn't even make at the time. You know, things like, you know, helicopters and armor things. There you go. There's one of his cool little helicoptery things he made. The guy was a genius, y'all. Now, we also had the great sculptor Michelangelo, who did this statue of David, you know, and that kind of thing. There's Michelangelo. Now, these kind of writers and thinkers and artists, y'all, they are really going to foment, right? They're going to create this interest about the world. They want people to know, and people want to know about the unknown. Right? That's going to be part of exploration. What the heck is out there? And so the Renaissance plays a key role in that. Also, you're going to see kind of a shift in priorities. Whereas people before, a lot in the Middle Ages, y'all, had focused purely on the spiritual world, you know, building those great Gothic cathedrals, doing all that stuff. Now they began to say, you know what? Maybe we shouldn't focus so much on this life, I mean, on the future life, the afterlife, as trying to maybe make this life a little bit better while we're still in it. So you're going to see the switch from from spiritualism and religion, perhaps, among some of your smarter people to a focus on the secular world, okay, the real world there. And of course, don't forget the other people in the Renaissance, Donatello, Raphael, you may have seen them before. Here they are, right? Teenage, ninja, mutant, turtles, or something like that. I remember my kids watching that. I don't know if you did, but anyway. Now, we need to go to the things that help Europeans, once they got over here, hold that power. How could a handful of Europeans, y'all, defeat thousands, ultimately millions of Native Americans? One of the keys is going to be gunpowder. And this also is something that was brought back, okay? This is also something that was brought back from the Crusades. There you go. There's a little bit from a firecracker. Now, during the Crusades, Europeans had gotten access to the Chinese invention of gunpowder. And there you see what it looks like, okay? Now, the gunpowder, when used, of course, in guns and cannons and things like that, along with the steel armor, the steel weapons, are going to allow the Europeans to prevail pretty easily over Native Americans. This is also easily remembered if you remember the term guns, germs, and steels, okay? Guns, germ, and steel. Mr. Janis used to have students read this. I don't know if he does anymore. It's a good book. It's a big book. It's kind of dull at times, but it's great information. All right, so there we go. Guns, germs, and steel. That's one of the big reasons Europeans could conquer so much of the world with so few people, y'all. Now, there's also going to be some scientific advancement, and AP calls these maritime advancements. Maritime advancements. Now, we have some new navigational aids, such as the compass. That's also something brought from the East, y'all. It allows you to know which way is north, and that's going to be kind of important, especially, you know, if you can't see the sun or whatever when you're trying to travel. Also, the astrolabe. As its name suggests, this was a device used at night, right? Astro, star. And you would point it at a star, and then you could measure the angle there, and using some math that Mr. D never understood, you can actually figure out your approximate location as far as latitude, your distance above or south of the equator. One perhaps easier to remember because of its name, sextant, is the sextant. And that is that allowed you to look at the sun. And if you knew the time, the date, and you had this book, you could actually figure out what latitude you were at. Longitude, y'all, we won't be able to figure at sea for some time until like the later in the 1700s, okay? But at least this gave you a good idea where you were. So it allows sailors to determine their location much more accurately. And I tell you, y'all, some people still use these. You know, GPS doesn't always work anymore, right? Sometimes that fails and you have to figure out when you're at sea, where the heck am I? Which is kind of important. So here you see a young sailor using a sextant at sea, okay? The next invention to talk about is something called the caravel. And this was really, really important, y'all. Now, back in the day when I was in high school and in college, I used to do something called windsurfing. Windsurfing is where you have a surfboard and you got a sail and you basically can use the wind to propel you across on your surfboard. And we would surf across lakes and things like that. Well, the trouble with that is any moron can sail if the wind is at your back and it's blowing right into your sail. The difficulty came, as I quickly found out, when I get to the other side of the lake, how the heck am I going to get back if the wind is blowing right in my face? Well, what the Portuguese eventually were able to figure out was a way to manipulate the sails and to manipulate the rudder that allowed them to do what we call tacking. Tacking is when you do a series of like zigzags that allows you to make your way back home. or Into the Wind. You aren't selling directly Into the Wind. That's never going to work. But if you do like that, and you do like that, and you do like that, you can get home. And, you know, that's kind of important when you're recruiting people. Like, hey, can you prove I'm going to get back? Well, we're still working on the getting back part, but we can get you there. Okay. So that became really important. There's a cool caravel, y'all. It's no accident that 2/3 of Columbus's 3 ships, both the Nina and the Pinta, were caravels. Okay. So that's going to play a big role. You've got to have the ships to get there and to get back. The next thing, y'all, is going to be improvements in cartography. Now, cartography is the science of map making. Now, early maps, y'all, let's just say they had problems. If you look at this map, y'all, I mean, this ain't going to help you find anything. To me, it looks like a Tyrannosaurus Rex here. Like, okay, go up here, turn at his first upper tooth, then go to his second, okay? Go to his third vertebrae. I mean, I have a hard time finding anything here. Well, what's going to happen during the Renaissance is they're going to get a whole lot better at this. And the maps are, because of the printing press, the next thing we're going to talk about, are going to become cheaper, and they can be produced easier and distributed. And so people like Columbus and other would-be explorers will have access to this kind of stuff. So that's another key thing, okay? And this is some of the beautiful maps that came about really not much later after Columbus. This is a few years after him because it's got South America and that. This is probably the 1600s or so. But, you know, maybe even early 1700s, but you can see how the science of map making improved a great deal. Now, let's go to how those maps and the stories of voyages could be sent to people. Well, in 1439, just 50 years or so before Columbus, this spinning guy here by the name of Gutenberg invents something called the mechanical press, or the mechanical printing press. Now, like everything else, y'all, the Chinese had invented it first. I mean, pretty much, if they ask you who invents something, you say Chinese. If Chinese isn't a choice, you say Thomas Edison or Ben Franklin, and you're probably okay. But the Chinese had invented this, but their printing press, y'all, was different. They would carve on a block of wood pretty much the whole page, right? So once you used it, you couldn't use it for another book. This was his genius, y'all, to, of course, have a press where he could put the stuff on there and to press it into it. But also this, okay, movable type. Now, at first it was wood. That wears out really quickly. Then it would be steel. Now, notice these letters are backward because once you ink them and you put paper on top of them, you get the mirror effect, and now suddenly you could see it. Each of these, y'all, were individual letters. Imagine putting together all of those to make a whole page of a book. Imagine having to do a whole book. But the beauty was, once you put a page together, y'all, and they would actually do multiple pages at one time, you would put the paper on top of it, you would press down on it. That is where we get the term press for, like, the media, meaning whether you work on TV or whatever, you're part of the press. You would do that. Later, the pages would be cut, and then they would be assembled together. Now, that still seems crazy when you and I can hit print, and we can print out a book in a matter of seconds. But compared to having only one copy after a person spent maybe a year or two writing by hand a single copy, this is a big step. And the only thing I can compare it to, y'all, and I was actually there for it. I actually remember my first trip on the internet, y'all. I think it was like 1993 or so. I'd just gotten a new computer, and a friend of mine, and it had web access on something called AOL, and a friend of mine had a web page. I'm like, a web page? What is that? Okay, let me turn this thing on and type in those letters. And I go to my friend Nick's page. I'm like, this is awesome, right? And of course, it opened up a whole new world. Now, if Mr. D needed to know something, type it in. Boy, I could find it in a matter of seconds instead of having to go to the old library and look it up and that kind of thing. Books became available. And you guys and me, we live in the world's greatest era of knowledge, okay? That was the kind of jump that we had, y'all, when we went from handwritten books to printed books. So what this means is books can be printed much more cheaply, and you can spread the news of those discoveries and voyages. Now, this is one of the rare Gutenberg Bibles. There's only a handful of these. I had to open it up this morning when I took this picture in my up in my library. I wish, except this is at UT right now. I've kindly decided to loan it to UT for the next few years. So anyway, but there you go. Now, the next thing, y'all, is going to be sort of a political thing, and that is the rise of the nation state. Now, remember how we said nobody had the dinero, had the money to do this type of exploring? Well, what happens, y'all, is after the Middle Ages, you start seeing all those tiny little kingdoms merging together to form what you and I today call countries or nations. If you want to be really correct, people are supposed to call them nation states. So you see Portugal become one. Spain will become united. England and France and the Netherlands will become united. And of course, these are going to be very competitive countries. They're going to want resources. They're going to want national pride, national glory. And religiously, they're going to want converts for their religion. So these are the new unified states that you see created. Instead of those little tiny feudal kingdoms, princedoms or dukedoms or whatever, principalities or dukedoms that you had during the Middle Ages. You see countries like France as we know it today, England, eventually Scotland will be added to it, Spain will become united, Portugal, and Germany and Italy. That's going to take until the 1860s, right? That's going to be a little bit later. Now, the thing is, y'all, because these encompassed a lot more people, a lot more area, they had that money. And they also had that ambition to pay for and to desire exploration. Now, when you guys are writing an AP, and I know Mr. Janice, we talked about it today, calls it the unicorn point, you know, getting complexity. And it is difficult. But if you bring it up multiple times, you might get that extra point on essays or DBQs or whatever. But here's an interesting connection. I like to compare what happened, y'all, to once again, one of my favorite topics, the space or moon race of the 1960s that I lived through. You know, we would have never, at least, I don't know if we still would have ever gone to the moon, y'all, if we hadn't been competing with the Soviets. Now, no other country had the money or the desire at the time to do it. But the United States and the USSR were maybe not trying. Well, they were trying to get converts, but converts to their economic system. Americans wanted people to be capitalists, to believe in free enterprise, right? The Soviets wanted people to become communists. And they sort of believed that whoever had the greatest successes in space, that would prove that their system was the better system. And so when the Russians launched the space age in October 1957 with Sputnik, America had to compete. And ultimately, President Kennedy made that great speech where he said, "I believe by the end of this decade that the United States should send a man to the moon, land him safely, and return him to the earth," right? Or something about like that. And sure enough, y'all, that's exactly what we did. And on July 20th, 1969, Mr. D's in first grade. And what happens? We do it. USA. USA. Russians never got there, y'all. And we've never really gone back, right? But the thing is, this kind of competition encourages you to do it. So this is what I'm going to end it with today. Watch the flag. All right, so we're going to stop there, y'all. That's it for the day. Hopefully that wasn't too painful for you guys. Let me come back to it. Any questions or anything? Remember. Okay, bye-bye. So we're starting with the rise of the nation state. Okay. Now, what we get, y'all, during this time, and this is going to be a key to colonization, conquest, exploration, and all that, is the beginning of what you and I today call nation states, or more likely we call countries. Now, what we have is these places that, you know, once upon a time had been these little city-states, or feudal kingdoms, or principalities, dukedoms, or whatever, that were only a few square miles and maybe a few hundred or thousand people. Well, they start to unify, and they become the countries that you and I know today. Countries like La Belle France, L'Espagne, or Elspagne, whatever. Portugal, eventually Germany. England and Scotland. Ireland, right? Poland, places like that. And so that makes a big difference, y'all, because now you got a lot more people, and you got a bunch more money, and you can do things like explore. Now, you guys may know on AP tests, there is a point called complexity. Complexity is often called the unicorn point because, man, you see it given about as often as you see a unicorn, okay, or maybe a pair of unicorns. But I think it is possible, and sometimes, especially among the more maybe the more ambitious of you, it's not a bad thing to try. And I think if you bring it up multiple times in an essay, you might get that reader to give it to you. But I like it also for contextualization, because you also can talk not just about what came before an event, but you can also talk about what follows it sometime later and bears a similarity to it. We used to call this synthesis, and it was a separate point, but AP stopped doing that. All right, so what I like to do, y'all, is compare things that happened in your parents' lifetimes, recent history, with things that happened back then. Now, I grew up during the space race when America was fighting to go to the moon. Now, in the 1960s, actually in 1957, the Soviet Union put up the world's first satellite. It embarrassed the heck out of us, y'all. We thought we were the greatest country in the world. We were the superpower. But this country, the USSR, had beaten us. They then also put up the first animal in space, a dog by the name of Laika, which sadly died in space because of heat exhaustion, becoming the first hot dog in space. I know, sorry. We put up a chimpanzee. So the big question then was, who could put up the first man in space? Soviets beat us with that in April 1960. Finally, America put a man in space. And with that success, President Kennedy said, I believe this nation should, before the century is out, commit itself to landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth, right? And of course, we begin this incredible race with the Soviet Union. Now, we might not still have ever gone to the moon, y'all, but our prestige was on the line. You know, we had to prove to the world, we had to prove to the Soviet Union that our system was better than their communist system. They had to prove to the world that their system, communism, right, planned economies, was better than our system. And somehow going to the moon would prove that. And so there's this natural competition. And what is it for? Well, there weren't many resources on the moon, at least that we knew of then, but there was a lot of glory in going to the moon. And that was incredibly important. But we also, as superpowers, we had the money to do it. Others don't. And did we do it? Heck yeah. July 1969, Mr. D is in first grade, getting ready for first grade, living in Missigitdown Sippy, and this is it. Neil Armstrong on the moon. And if you look at that flag, y'all, it does something amazing. USA. USA. Yeah, okay, so you get the idea, right, y'all? It was, I mean, it was that type of competition, except there were several countries involved in this. Okay, so let's look at the story of Spain, because Spain, y'all, was the superpower of its time. And how does that happen? Well, ultimately, you get two great kingdoms coming together because of a marriage. Isabella, Ferdinand hook up, and they hook up their two kingdoms, and the result is you get this new thing really called Spain. Now, there are casualties along the way. They had fought a 700, I repeat, almost 800-year long civil war, y'all, to drive people out who were Muslims. These Muslims had invaded many hundreds of years before, and they were known as Moors, M-O-O-R-S. They had come there, and they had made a big impact on Spain. You can still go to Spain and see a lot of their cool architecture and all of that. But Spain was trying to, quote, purify itself and to get rid of all Moors, also to get rid of all Jews. And they accomplished this by 1492. This is all part of something called the Reconquista, the reconquering, right, of Spain. Now, they also do something else. Anybody that might be considering leaving the Catholic faith and becoming one of these Protestants or something, they have to face something known as the Spanish Inquisition. Now, an Inquisition is where questions are asked. This was the question that was asked at the Inquisition, you know, are you Catholic? Do you believe in the one and only true faith? Do you renounce all other faiths? That was basically what they asked him. And if you refused, well, this might happen to you. But before that, remember, nobody...
I didn't expect a kind of Spanish Inquisition. Nobody expects the Spanish Inquisition. I
cheap weapon is surprise. Surprise and fear. Fear and surprise are two weapons. Are fear and surprise and ruthless efficiency are three weapons. Are fear and surprise and ruthless efficiency and an almost fanatical devotion to the Pope are four. No. Amongst our weapons.
All right, so the Spanish Inquisition. Now, here you see a very disturbing picture of a man on a wheel. They are breaking him here, y'all. He's tied to the wheel. And as you can see, they're turning it, and he is being burned as he makes his way around. In a way, y'all, I guess what they're doing is a preview for what hell is supposed to be like. So it's sort of like, and I know this sounds crazy today, but the idea is, look, we're inflicting pain on you now to save you from a terrible pain in the future, because they truly believe, as crazy as today, they truly believe if you weren't in the right particular faith, you were going to burn in hell forever. And that is a long, long time. And so they might work and work and work to finally get you to renounce any other heretical faiths and embrace Catholicism. So this is the dirty side, y'all, of Spanish's treatment. And some people made it a deal to say, hey, what the Spanish were doing to their own people isn't going to be a whole lot worse or less worse than what they're going to end up doing to the native inhabitants of the areas they're going to conquer, right? The English kind of do the same with some of my ancestors, the Irish, right, who they see as Catholic, awful people, and try to get them to embrace their Protestant faith. Now, another thing, y'all, that comes out of this is, of course, a guy by the name of Prince Henry the Navigator. Now, he was a prince, as the name suggests. He was a Portuguese, and he starts a navigation school that will basically train the great navigators to get to make this age of exploration possible. I don't know about you, but I think that is an awesome hat. I kind of wish I had one. Now, the thing is, if you guys have seen Star Wars, right, the original one, you know, whatever they call it, something of hope or something like that. Now, when Luke Skywalker needs somebody to fly, right, he goes where? To a bar, right? And there he meets Han Solo. In a way, y'all, Portugal was like that bar during this time. It was the place you went if you needed a good navigator, if you needed good sailors. Now, what the Portuguese excelled in doing, y'all, was making their way down Africa. And speaking of Star Wars, that hat reminds me of the lovely princess here and her hat. Okay, from the Phantom Menace, right? Now, explorers, y'all, were sent to make their way down the coast of Africa. They really had no idea how big Africa was. They also were to defeat any Muslims along the way that might threaten them again in the future. Of course, to spread their faith of Christianity and make sure that there are trade routes. And indeed, this is what Portugal did. And so it is Prince Henry, y'all, that in a lot of way launches this great age of discovery that will go on for over 100 years. So it's kind of interesting, y'all. I've not been to Portugal. I've not been to Spain. They're two of the countries in Europe that I haven't been to. It's amazing when you think of that small country today being so powerful and being so important. And, of course, today it's neither, right? That's kind of sad, but that's what happens lots of times to great nations. Now, the next thing to talk about here is Europeans making their way to Africa, because this is going to be kind of a preview, y'all, of what's going to happen in the Americas, right? So to get around going through Constantinople, which had been closed, right, the Portuguese think, hey, we'll just go around Africa. I mean, how big can it be, right? So they make their way down here and here. They discover the Cape Verde Islands and the Azores and those kind of cool things. And then they like turn and like, what the heck? It's big, you know? And then they keep going on and eventually they make their way all the way to India. I mean, really, really impressive stuff that they were able to accomplish that. But also, y'all, as they make their way down, they begin to start setting up trade. And these trading posts will be the beginning of European enslavement of Africans. Now, what did they offer for slaves? Gold, but ultimately they offered weapons. They offered various things that could not be made or weren't being made in Africa quite yet. And so who were these slaves? Well, I hate to say it, but Africans captured fellow Africans in war, right? And would trade them for these kind of things. Now, some of you might go, Mr. D, man, that is wrong. Africans selling Africans. How could they be doing that? Well, That's because you're using your idea of this African unity and things that we might have today. They didn't have that, y'all. All they saw it is better those guys than me, right? I will trade them and I'll get some really cool stuff. They didn't see the world, you know, as you and I do through this kind of lens of, you know, race and ethnicity and that kind of thing. That is our modern construct, right? Now, these people, as they got captured, would be marched to the coast. They would be, like we said, exchanged for weapons, gold, whatever. And then they were taken to plantations. Now, these early plantations, y'all, aren't in America. They're off the coast of Africa and off the coast of Portugal. Places like the Azores, the island of Madeira, the Canary Islands, named for dogs, by the way, y'all, not little yellow birds that the putty cat is trying to get. And also the Cape Verde Island. I've not been to these places, man, but if you'd like to donate money someday so Mr. D could go, that would be great. I'll see about a tax deduction for you. But anyway, but that's where they took these people. So what did they do? Well, the early plantations, y'all, were all about doing one thing, sugar. Sugar was like the crack of its time, and I hate to say it that way, but people were addicted to it. There were no substitutes. They tried to grow sugar in Italy and in Mediterranean climates. It was tough, and they weren't doing very well. But the soil, the climate was fine here. And so these poor people, y'all, were forced to work on these islands to do that very thing. Now, sadly, the money was so much, y'all. And once again, it's like drugs, I hate to say. You made so much money by raising sugar and selling it. They could afford to buy these human beings, work them to death, and throw them away like you and I might throw away, I don't know, a mask, you know, a disposable mask or something today. That's how they did it. And they still came out ahead. It's awful, y'all. But that is the plantation system, and Portugal is the one that starts it. The Spanish copy it. Ultimately, the English and French will bring it over here to the Americas and do it here as well, too. So understand where that begins and why it begins. They made a lot of money, and sadly, they used it to enslave a lot of people to get those goods. Now we get to one of the most controversial figures today. You've seen his statues probably being torn down. That's kind of ironic because I grew up hearing this guy to be a hero. And but of course, we've all learned some things about him, and I'll share some of those that have made us think a little bit more in a complex way about Cristoforo Colombo or Cristobal Colon, or as we say in America, Christopher Columbus. Now, I just so happen to be wearing my Christopher Columbus tie today. I have a large collection of ties, y'all. You don't get to see them, sadly, since we're not really in class. But this has got Columbus. It's got a compass rose. It's got his ships on it, even some of his handwriting, right? And so anyway, y'all, so let's talk about who this Columbus dude was. First of all, y'all, he was a son of like a cloth merchant, but a very ambitious person. And he loved sailing, and he loved navigating. And to be honest, he was a pretty good navigator. And he comes up with this idea to sail, to get to the east by sailing not south like the Portuguese were doing around Africa, but by sailing west. And he goes around, he talks to Henry VII, I think it was. He talks to the French king. He talks to the Spanish king and queen. And all of them are basically saying, look, dude, no. And he goes around and he keeps asking them. And this is what they basically say every time he comes around and asks them.
Don't come around.
Yep. So that's what they told him. Don't come around here anymore. Now, when I was a kid, we heard this story. And I don't know if it was Washington Irving or whoever started this stupid story. But the story goes like this. They said no to Columbus because Columbus told them the world was round. And they didn't think the world was round. They thought the world was flat. And they said, Columbus, you could just fall off the earth if you tried doing that. Well, no. Anybody with any brains, y'all, knew that the world was round. The ancient Greeks had done that. Why they said no, y'all, and they got their best scientists and mathematicians together, and they looked at Columbus's numbers, and they said, dude, you are so far off. You are saying that the earth is about a quarter or a third of the size that it really is. If you sail west, you're going to run into this giant ocean, and there's probably monsters in it, and you are going to die. You're going to run out of food. You're going to run out of water, and it's going to be a disaster. That is why they said no. And so Columbus Shaw persisted. And let me just show y'all here. Let me be here. Okay. Can you see the globe here? All right. He's got the whole world in his hands. Anyway. All right. So here you got Spain, right? You got your Spain over here. You got your Portugal. You got what's known of Africa. Well, Columbus thinks, y'all, if I just sail over here, maybe 3,000 miles tops, boom, I'm going to hit the Indies. I'll hit the Japan. I'll hit the China. I'll have all those places. It's a whole lot easier than this other thing. And they're like, Columbus, dude, you didn't carry the map. You didn't carry the one. Your math is bad. The world is like three times as big as you say. And of course, we know they were right. Columbus, and they didn't know about North and South America. They didn't know about this little thing called the Pacific Ocean, you know? They didn't know, you know, and so Columbus, y'all, was lucky. Had there not been a North and South America, his men would have done exactly like they said. He would have died out there of exhaustion. Okay, so let me go to, why is it presenting here? Is it going back to the PowerPoint? Let's see. Nope. Okay, let me try that again, y'all. Here we go. It's showing up on the screen. All righty. So you should be getting it back here. There we go. All right. So I guess you can say this about Columbus, y'all.
Missed it by that much.
That he missed it by that much and quite a bit, right? Now, eventually, though, he's able to convince Ferdinand and Isabella, who've just now united Spain and have this strong national desire to do something great. They back it. They give him three ships. They give him about 100 men or so. And all Columbus asks is this, y'all. He's like, look, I will get this for you. All I want is a title, Admiral of the Ocean Seas, and 10% commission. Now, it's important to understand this, y'all, because this shows us Columbus's ambition, maybe a little bit of just the way he was as far as what he needed, as far as his, ego and that kind of thing. But also the 10% is going to be a big thing. He's promising them untold wealth, and he wants some of that, too. And it's going to lead him to do some pretty cruel things to try to get some of that money. All right, y'all. Now, the next thing is, these are the ships, right? He had two of these cool new caravels, the Nina, the Pinta. These were fast, y'all. And I've actually been on these ships. Pretty cool. And it gave me a lot of respect for what Columbus and his men were able to accomplish in these tiny, tiny things. These ships were small, y'all. They're about the size of two classrooms connected together and maybe not even quite as wide as a classroom. That would be your home with about 15 or 20 other men for a couple of months, maybe even 3 or 4 months. And there was a third ship, which was his flagship. And this, of course, is the Santa Maria, or the Santa Maria, as we say it here in Merca. Now, this ship was bigger. Imagine maybe two stories tall and maybe three classrooms long. And there, y'all, you had about, 60, 55 men or so in the Santa Maria. The Santa Maria will ultimately run aground on Christmas. Believe it or not, the crew got all drunk, and they let a young boy be captain of the night, and he ran it on the reefs, and they ended up using the wood from that to build a fort, the first kind of permanent, or not even permanent, but the first attempt at a settlement by the Spanish, and this was in Hispaniola, okay? Now, let's talk about the voyage here, y'all. It takes 6 long weeks. Imagine, y'all, really no bath. You're crammed in to 2 or 3 classrooms, 60 of you, 30 of you, whatever, for 6 weeks. And, of course, Columbus kept lying to the men to a certain extent. You know, back in the day when I was a kid and my parents would take us on long trips, I would always bug my parents. I'm like, you know, are we there yet? How much longer? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? Well, you guys can check now on your cell phones, but we couldn't do that. And the parents would say, we got 30 more minutes. Like, well, you said that 30 minutes ago. And so Columbus was kind of the same way, but in a way different, because the men kept saying, Columbus, we should be there by now. And Columbus was like, oh, no, man, look here. Let me show you here on the map. We haven't traveled as far as you think. And Columbus would be like, oh man, we should be there now. So he kind of kept two different selling locks. Okay. Now the food was terrible. And I think it's appropriate before lunch to talk to y'all about the food, because this will make you really, really want to eat lunch here. First of all, what happened was the men were given kind of a biscuity stuff, right? Yeah, they'd get there some, they'd had some fish, salted fish, that stuff. But they relied a lot on this biscuit kind of bread stuff. And it was really, really hard for one thing. Well, it didn't take long, y'all, for flies to discover it and lay their eggs, which become maggots. Maggots are those tiny little worms that get into things. So they were eating and living in their, basically their bread, y'all. So what became the habit is that you didn't really eat much until nighttime. Why? Well, this is what you'd do. You'd get your biscuit, you'd soak it in the water, and you'd drown the maggots, right? So that when you ate it, they weren't crawling around in your mouth, because that's what would happen if you ate during the day without drowning them. And think about it, y'all. You get some extra protein. Pretty awesome, right? And then, of course, they had some wine, but the wine got air in it. Wine plus air equals vinegar. So they had that problem as well, too. So food was terrible. And I guess you could say that
this sucks more than anything that I've ever sucked before.
Yeah, words of wisdom. And so with his men near mutiny, and you guys would be too, Columbus is getting nervous. And he finally says, look, y'all, I will give you like a year's pay to the first person who sees land. And amazingly, y'all, on October 12th, 1492, and why I say that's amazing is that's Columbus Day. What are the chances that Columbus would discover land on the day that's named for him? It's amazing. What a coincidence. And so on October 12th, 1492, a man by the name of Diego yells out, Tierra, Tierra, land. And of course, Columbus is like, yeah, I saw it last night. And he kept the money, by the way. Now, I just so happen to have rare historical footage of Columbus. Early GoPro here, y'all. Now, keep this image in your mind, what the land looks like according to Hollywood here. This is a Frenchman playing the Italian who is selling for the Spanish. There it is. And there was much rejoicing. There goes the Santa Maria. Kind of hauling there, buddy. You got some reefs. I'd be careful. All right, so let's get Columbus and his men ashore, y'all. They make their way ashore, and so you can see that. Now, life moved at a slower pace back then, as you guys will see. So here we go. Even gravity was slower, right? Notice the water takes longer to come up and go back down. Island. And of course, Columbus Day, October 12, 1492. And the world would never be the same from that. Now, Guajahani is named for a large reptile that lives on that island. You and I know them as iguanas, right? So there you go. And the spotter, well, he never got his money. He drowned on a later voyage. He never got the Marivetes, okay? Just the way it sort of is. So where did Columbus land? Well, he didn't really land in what we call America today, right? He landed in the Bahamas. you know, where you and I go on cruises, right? Which hopefully we can be able to do again soon. I'm supposed to do one at Christmas. But anyway, so the island he called San Salvador, right? Basically the savior, because he and his men were so grateful. They had been saved, y'all. I mean, Columbus literally probably was saved by landing here. Don't confuse it, of course, with the capital of the country of El Salvador, which is in Central America. He called it San Salvador. Now, he never, ever comes back. And so for years, y'all, people asked, historians asked, where did Columbus really land? Well, there was an island, and a lot of islands claim this is where Columbus landed. We were Columbus landed. No, we were where Columbus landed. But an island by the name of Watling Island is the best candidate. And in the 1920s, it actually renamed itself. 100 years ago, it renamed itself San Salvador. And they found all kinds of evidence, and I'm really convinced that this is where he really landed. And you'll see why in just a sec. Now, in May of 2001, a very brave, very, very brave person decided to journey to San Salvador. All right? Taking a very dangerous aircraft by a company called Bahamas Air, which he called Bahamas Scare. This person journeyed to San Salvador almost 20 years ago. It was this person's honeymoon. From the air coming into it, it looked just like Columbus had described, with this large brackish area of water, part salt, part freshwater, right in the middle. Okay, here's an airport. This was Terminal A, Terminal B and C. This is where they all landed. Now, based on what Columbus wrote, this place matches perfectly his description of where he came ashore. You can see how rocky that water is. That's not very deep, y'all, before you start running on the rocks there. But notice this. It ain't like that movie. This is very, very, you know, there's not very many high places. You got the sandy beach and all of that, okay? Now, and here's another picture of that bay. And this is where the world changed forever, y'all, where Columbus came ashore 500 years before. And this may shock you, but look at Columbus walking ashore. And who is that brave explorer? It is none other than Mr. D. Mr. D carrying this heavy cross to mark where Columbus came from, all the way from Houston, Texas. This incredible plaque as well, too, commemorating the 500th anniversary of Columbus landing ashore, even posing with an even older one. Amazing, y'all. Now, the next question here, though, really does show an interesting connection. Now, my wife is a science and math person, right? So here we are, we're standing here, and here is this really cool metal kind of sculpture, and it's for a flame. Normally, there's a flame burning there. And notice it says Mexico and has the Olympic logo. So my wife asked this question. Why is this in San Salvador? And I said, well, that's why it's a good thing that you married a history teacher. Let me tell you. So this is the deal, y'all. Without San Salvador, without Columbus, there is no Mexico as you and I know it, because that is where Mexico begins. Those Spanish arriving at San Salvador will ultimately make their way to Central America, right? Or to Mesoamerica, Middle America, to what today we call Mexico. There, those men will have children by Indian women, creating the modern day Mexican person, right? Most people in Mexico today, they're neither pure Spanish, right, or pure Indian. They're probably a mixture of both. The word we use, which some people find offensive, but it is what the Spanish called them, is mestizo, meaning mixed or mixture. That is what Mexico is. So Mexico in 1968, when they hosted the Olympics, actually put this object there. Today, people probably aren't as comfortable with honoring Columbus and what he started. But in 1968, y'all, people felt a whole lot differently about it. Now, as an intrepid explorer, y'all, I want you to see the primitive conditions that I had to endure to be able to bring you back these stories, y'all. It was rough. This primitive beach, sitting there daily. Sometimes my drinks would arrive late. It was rough. Having to look at beautiful ladies and go sailing and scuba diving and wait for Bruce the Shark to show up at 3 o'clock every day. This was my life for a week while I investigated history, y'all. And this was also my view from my room every day. And out here, y'all, we saw lots of incredible little reptiles called iguanas, which had given the name to the island. And my wife, y'all, has been a big fan of iguanas ever since then, okay? Now, Columbus would ultimately make three more voyages. And on that first voyage, y'all, he visited Cuba. He visited what he called Hispaniola. Today, it's modern-day Haiti and the Dominican Republic. He discovers Puerto Rico, the rich port, right? Hence its name. The Virgin Islands, which he named St. Croix, St. John, St. Thomas, right, after various saints, other islands. And you notice he made his way all over the Caribbean, y'all. But you notice something else. He never lands in what you and I think of as America, that is, the United States. He doesn't even get close to Mexico, y'all. And so there's the big question is, did this guy ever know that he had discovered two unknown continents? It seems like he never admitted it to himself. He kept calling it the Indies, or thinking he was close to the Indies. Therefore, all the people he ran into were, quote, Indians, which is why we have confusion to this day. Now, Columbus might have been a great sailor. He might have been a great navigator, but he wasn't very good as a governor. And part of it, y'all, was the fact that he's an Italian guy ordering Spanish people around. And they didn't like that, right? And so when he started quarreling with a couple of his officials, and ultimately he ordered two of them hanged, the Spanish got upset and they ordered him arrested. And so he actually came back in chains after his third voyage. Now, his fourth voyage is a much happier one, and that's a whole separate story. But in the end, ironically, y'all, the continents don't even get his name. You and I don't live in North Columbia and South Columbia. You and I don't sing, and I'm proud to be a Colombian, and we don't chant USC, USC, United States of Columbia, right? What do we say? United States of America. So where does America come from? It comes from a fellow Italian by the name of Amerigo Vespucci. Now, Amerigo Vespucci had been one of the first people to figure out, hey, Columbus, you know, he didn't tell Columbus this, but hey, this isn't the Indies, dude. This is actually a whole new series of continents, a couple new continents. And so a German map maker decided, what do you call these continents? Well, I'm going to name them after the guy who figured out what they really were. And his name, Amerigo. Now, fortunately, he didn't call them Vespucci, or you and I would be Vespucians, which would be hard to say. But instead, he named him after his first name. So you and I become Americans, or Amerigans, I guess would be the better word. So he's the first to conclude that what had happened is two new continents had been discovered. So Columbus, as you guys know today, is a very complex person. If we had more time, I have articles, and I'll post them for you for those of you that really want to read and be more informed on this whole big issue, okay, about Columbus. I keep getting stupid messages, y'all, here. I apologize for that. I'm just going to turn this thing off, okay? And anyway, so what are the positives? Why did people see this guy as a hero for a long time? Well, he was brave. He was daring. He basically connected two worlds that otherwise had not been connected. Now, somebody eventually would have done it. Fortunately, or maybe unfortunately, I don't know, it was him. He creates this permanent link. The world is never going to be the same, okay, as a result of what he did. Incredibly courageous, brave man. And, of course, if you're an Italian-American, or even for a long time Spanish-Americans, they were very proud of Columbus and what he had accomplished. Hey, we beat the English. We beat the French. Nobody else did this, right? And so you see a lot of Italian-Americans still celebrating Columbus Day. Other people, including countries, have gotten rid of Columbus Day and replaced it with Indigenous Peoples Day, or Native Americans Day, right, to honor Native Americans that Columbus, they believe, killed, okay? So the negatives as well, y'all. Columbus and his policies begin a series of brutality against Native Americans, a system that we'll talk more about later. Thousands, ultimately probably millions, die. Now, does Columbus actually ever physically kill anybody? I don't think so. He never did that. But his policies would. Now, to get the money when gold wasn't discovered, Columbus and his governors began the policy of requiring Indians to find X amount of gold every month or every quarter or whatever. And indeed, if Indians didn't find it, their hands might be cut off. And in fact, they would separate men and women into different groups and have them work, trying to find this gold, this silver, this copper, all these kind of things. And of course, their numbers began to fall. The biggest killer isn't going to be Spanish bullets or Spanish steel. It's going to be Spanish germs. Now, Columbus didn't inflict his germs on anybody. They didn't understand that. They just knew, hey, the Indians are getting sick, right? The Indians must be weak or something is how they viewed it. It was another thing that contributed to the sense of superiority. Hey, I get a cold or I get the measles. I don't die. This guy gets the measles. He gets smallpox. He dies. Man, what's the matter with him? Okay. The other thing is, too, Columbus will also capture a number of slaves or a number of Indians, and he will take them back home to the Americas, from the Americas. Sorry, I just had a visitor coming in, y'all, so I got a little discombobulated there. Anyway, he will capture Indians and bring them back for the queen and the king to look at, okay? And so most of these will die. But it begins the policy of Indian slavery. Indians enslaved each other. I mean, we know that because Columbus, when he saw the Indians on San Salvador, there was evidence of torture and all kinds of things. And they were terrified of neighboring Indians called the Caribs, who are the ancestors of what we today call cannibals. So Columbus knew there were some bad dudes out there and they were doing bad things to each other. But he's the guy who starts with the policy of bringing Indians to enslaving Indians. Well, when the Indians turn out not to make very good slaves, Africans will replace them. So this is the complexity here, y'all. Like I said, there's a lot of things to admire about this guy, but maybe at the same time now, you understand why a lot of people also have a problem with this guy, okay? Remember the irony, right? Columbus, we don't think ever really truly realized he discovered two unknown continents. Remember, Columbus got in a lot of trouble. He was not very competent as far as a politician or a governor and ended up actually getting into trouble when he hanged several Spaniards. Spaniards didn't want him hanging people. They said, that's our job. Only we can hang Spaniards, not some Italian dude. And so anyway, he got brought back in chains. But he did have a good last voyage. But as you can see here, he got to Central America. He got all through the Caribbean. But he never got to what you and I think of as the United States of America. And the final irony, or insult, however you want to look at it, is the continents never got his name. Instead, America, our continents, North and South, are named for an Italian by the name of Vespucci, whose first name is Amerigo. So you and I are all actually Americans as opposed to Americans. And so anyway, y'all, that's why we don't sing, and I'm proud to be a Colombian, or chant USC, USC, you know, and that kind of thing. So there we go. As far as Columbus's positives, as you guys know, Columbus is a real source of anger today. A video that I included that I'd like y'all to maybe sometime watch before next week I'll post it again and give you the link. It's called Worlds Transformed. And it's from a college course, and it opens with Columbus's statues being attacked. And you guys have seen that on the news. You've seen people like tearing him down, cutting his head off, throwing blood on him. I think he even ended up in the river the other day. And so what's up with that? Well, when I was a kid, we were taught Columbus was a great hero. We weren't talked about the negative aspects of the Columbian Exchange or what he had done. And so why would some people see him as a hero? Well, he was a great navigator. He was an incredible dreamer in the sense of trying to get to the east by whatever means, by going west to get east. He did change the world forever. I mean, that's pretty impressive by bringing these together. And for the most part, in a lot of ways, people would say it was good. But there's also a lot of negatives. And if you're an Italian-American, a lot of Italians have a great deal of pride in what Columbus did. And they've not been very happy about what you know, about the statues coming down and that kind of thing as well, too. All right, so let's talk more about the negatives, the cons, so to speak. And there's a whole article I have on this that kind of is a more balanced portrait of him. But definitely, one of the things that's been forgotten is Columbus, whether he did it or not, personally, it is his followers, and he begins the process by which diseases, brutality, is going to lead to the death of thousands and ultimately millions of people, probably maybe as many as 90% of the native population may pass away as a result of that. Also, Columbus practiced what a lot of people practiced at the time, and that is the terrible, terrible institution of slavery. First, Indians were used, Columbus forcing Indians to work for him to find gold, to find silver, and they could be treated very cruelly. Men and women might be separated. Hands might be cut off, allegedly, for those who didn't find what they needed to. So this, of course, is going to lead to the death of a lot of folks. And when Native Americans don't end up making very good slaves, Africans are going to be brought in to replace them. So indirectly, Columbus can be, you know, accused of starting, at least in the Americas, what becomes America, the practice of slavery, although it had been going on in Africa, Europe, Asia, all over the world, but he can be accused of that. All right, y'all. So what we're going to go to now is talking about some other factors that AP mentions. We've already talked about the improvements in maritime technology, but what I want to look at here today is better ways to do trade. And that is going to mean talking about joint stock companies. And also I'm going to talk about changes in economies, but I'm also going to bring up one thing that is, it's kind of interesting because it's a result of the Columbian Exchange. It's the result of discovery, but it is going to end up leading to a lot of the conquest and a lot of the colonization. Okay. So we're going to go through and look at that. Now these notes are the notes that I put up. They're like called part two. If you don't have them, hopefully you can get those. All right, so the first thing to look at, y'all, is the population explosion in Europe that is created. And since it's an explosion, what does that sound like, Mr. D? Yeah, dynamite. And so, those kids, those babies, they just keep making noise. Oh, my gosh. Don't you wish you could do this in real life, y'all? Your little baby brother and sister's crying, so what do? You just dial it down. Now you can't hear them. Okay. Wish I'd had that about 24 years ago when my daughter was born. But anyway, so what happened, y'all? Well, you know, the Columbian Exchange is going to include several crops that are going to absolutely change the diet of Europeans. The biggie is going to be potatoes. Now, the beauty of potatoes is this, y'all. If you plant them, they grow underground, right? So let's say the army comes through and they trample all over your fields. You got your mashed potatoes. Let's say they set fire to your fields. What you got? That's right, baked potatoes, and so forth and so on. They're pretty safe. And, you know, an acre or two of potatoes can go a long way to feeding a family. So suddenly, maybe you could only handle having two or three kids. Now you might have four or five. Multiply this across the continent, and boom, you got your population explosion. Also, you add things like corn and all that. All these different things, Europeans, y'all, now we're having more kids and more kids were surviving. Now, that's great, right? Everybody likes having more kids. But the trouble is, where are these people going to live? What kind of jobs are they going to have? Will there be land? So what do a lot of them do? They're literally squeezed out of Europe, y'all, and they will come to this so-called New World to look for that land, to get those jobs, okay? Now, the next concept you guys need to be aware of is what's called primogeniture. The root word primo, meaning first, geniture, meaning born. So this used to be the practice in Europe, and this is an important concept, y'all, because you will hear about this again in the revolution. You know, a lot of people diss America's revolution. They say, man, America's revolution, it didn't change anything, just the names of the leader. But one thing that does change is the fact that we in the United States pretty much get rid of this required practice. Now, it makes some sense when you think about it. It seems really unfair, right? I mean, I can hear somebody like, Mr. D, that's just not fair. Well, yeah, but it makes some sense in this sense. Let's say you got five sons and you have 1,000 acres. So when it comes time for you to give them land, each of them gets 200 acres, right? Well, that's cool. You can live on 200 acres. But then each of the five sons has five sons, and they have to divide up their 200 acres among those five kids, and so forth and so on. So what ends up happening? Well, eventually it's like, son, when I die, this square foot of land is going to be all yours, right? And, you know, that just ain't, you know, you can't live on that, right? And so the decision was made. Look, we're just going to give it all to the firstborn son. But you go, but man, I'm secondborn. I'm thirdborn. What am I going to get? You're going to get squat. You're going to get nothing. You're going to have to fend for yourself. So what do? Well, there's always the army. You can join the military, as the Brits say. Military, not military. Or you can join the priesthood and do that. But when this new world gets discovered, y'all, guess what? There's a third choice. That's right. Come to America. Come to the new world. So we got a lot of these people, y'all, the second born, the third born, and fourth born. Now, I can hear some of you saying right away, like, all right, Mr. D, you talked about sons. What about us ladies? What about the daughters? Well, guess what? And I hate to say it. Daughters weren't even considered part of the package. You couldn't inherit land. In fact, I hate to say it even more. When a daughter was born, it was sort of like, man, bad luck, dude, better luck next time. Because daughters were expensive. A daughter, y'all, had to be provided with what was called a dowry. What that means is when your daughter got married, you had to give her, your new son-in-law, her husband, right, your new son-in-law, something. Give him land. Give him money. Because he was taking this daughter off your hands. And also, it was a way to make your daughter, quote, more attractive. I mean, can't you imagine some of the guys like, woo, that girl's got a great dowry, right? She's got a lot of land, okay? And that's sort of the way they were. And so that was expensive, right? Now you go, man, Mr. D, that's awful. I can't believe they're doing that to the ladies. Well, yeah, but we still have some remedy or residue of that today. When you get married, ladies, you're going to need to pay for the wedding, right? Who's supposed to pay for the wedding by custom in America usually? The father of the bride. It's just the way it's done. It may be fair. It may not be fair. Now, if you want to be progressive and cool, you can make the groom's father, your husband-to-be, pay for it. So we still actually have a bit of that legacy still left, y'all. But primogeniture is going to force a lot of people over here. Now, I took this picture in my bedroom's closet this morning of my gold. There you see it. Europe, y'all, during this time, Europe is going to be changing from an economy based purely on land, which is not very tradable overseas, to an economy based on gold, right? Based on precious metals. This is called mercantilism, where everything is valued in how much gold and silver. Whether you're a great country or not depends on how much gold and silver there. So the name of the game is going to be keep the gold, keep the silver, right? Keep as much of that as you can. So it's going to really help trade. But, you know, when you talk to these people at the time, y'all, this is about all they really cared about.
Seems all he thinks about is silver and gold. Silver and gold. Silver and gold. Everyone wishes for silver and gold. How do you measure its worth?
Just by the pleasure it gives us.
That's all they talked about, just like Rudolph's friend there with silver and gold. Now, what the gold was used for y'all was a method of trade, right? Because, you know, Europe didn't have a lot of stuff to trade with Asia, to trade with Africa, but they could trade gold. They could trade with silver. But the thing is, if gold and silver are the things you really want, you don't want that to leave. So this is the other key part of mercantilism you guys need to understand. And that is, you don't want the gold or silver to leave. You want to accumulate as much of it as possible. So what you did is you maximized your exports, stuff leaving your country, because people gave you gold and silver to buy it from other countries. You got more gold and silver. On the other hand, if you bought stuff from other countries, you had to give them gold and silver, which meant gold and silver leaving your country. So what does this have to do ultimately with America? This becomes one of the biggest reasons, y'all, for the American Revolution, one of the biggest economic reasons. Because America, y'all, was basically told who they could buy from and who they had to sell to and for how much. When Americans started, you know, coming up with stuff and wanting to sell it, they pretty much only had one buyer, England, for whatever England wanted to sell it for. And when America wanted to buy stuff, they pretty much had to buy from England. This was codified in a series of laws known as Navigation Acts. Now, at first, they weren't very enforced and nobody seemed to mind them. But over time, the English, especially after the French-Indian War, are going to really start enforcing those. and colonists are going to get mad. I mean, it'd be just like, you know, your mom or dad saying, okay, these can be your friends, but these people can't be your friends. You can hang with these people, but you can't hang with these people. You're not going to like it. And America didn't like it, and it became one of the biggest reasons for our revolution. Now, these this gold and silver, y'all, went towards building up giant armies and navies, which sadly would be used, especially by the Spanish, and it would be disastrous for them. So remember, mercantilism. Now, the last thing to talk about here, y'all, are joint stock companies. AP specifically mentions this in their curriculum. Anytime they do that, you got to know it. Okay, so let's say you and I want to start a colony, y'all. Man, that's going to cost us mucho dinero. We got to get us boats and ships and people. And, you know, there's a good chance that those people will sink or the colony will fail, or it'll be a disaster. And there goes our money. And we may have put our life savings into that. Man, that's awful. And that's what would happen if just a handful of people invest in it. So what the joint stock company did, y'all, was replace the investment by a handful of people with hundreds, maybe even thousands of them. And so this is essentially what today you and I would call a corporation. You know, McDonald's isn't owned by one person. Pizza Hut isn't owned by one person. It's owned by thousands of people, y'all, who have stock in the company, right? Who have part ownership. Think about it, y'all. If you own even one share of McDonald's, you can go around saying, yeah, McDonald's, yeah, that's mine. I'm an owner. Okay. When actually you own like 0.000000% of it, 1%, but you could technically say you're an owner. Now, as you guys know, I'm interested in the space race and that kind of thing, and I'll bring that up a lot. You guys have heard of the company called SpaceX, Elon Musk, personal hero of mine. He's taking a lot of chances, y'all, when he launches those rockets. If a rocket fails, and especially if a rocket has a crew on it, that is $1 billion or more probably that are lost. Even a rich guy like that is going to have a hard time surviving that. So what does he do? With a company like SpaceX, thousands of people can invest. He raises lots of capital. He has lots of money. Now, these people can benefit when SpaceX does well, when they make money, you know, by contracts. But if something bad happens, they're only out the price of their share. And that is the other advantage of joint stock companies, y'all, or corporations as we call them today, because you are never liable for more than your share. Let's say Mr. D invested, I don't know. Well, actually, I can tell you a real one. I'm invested in Carnival Cruise Lines. It's one of the few things I own stock in because I love ships, right? Well, cruise ships are having a hard time right now. Carnival having a hard time right now. If it were to go bankrupt and Carnival owed billions of dollars to various people, all they can do to me, the people that owe that they're owed money, can do is say, well, Bob, we'd love to take your house, your car, your wife, your dog. But all they can take away from me, y'all, is my stock. So let's say $10,000, $50,000 in shares. They can take that. That'll be nothing. But that is it. Okay. Now, if the voyage, if the colony is successful, y'all, they make a percentage. Let's say you own 10% of Jamestown. You get 10% of Jamestown's profits. But let's say Jamestown bombs. It fails like Croatoan did, or Roanoke, I should say, or the one up in Newfoundland failed. Well, then you're not out that much money. It's not your lifetime savings. So it's a way to minimize risk and a way to maximize a lot of capital. A lot of money to pay for this. So why is this important to us in AP US history? Because this is how England, y'all, paid for most of its colonies. England didn't have the resources of Spain or France just to say, all right, you and you and you, you go start colonies. England's like, man, we don't have any money. But fortunately, we got a bunch of rich guys and other people who will invest their money and they'll start a colony. They'll name it Jamestown, or they'll start another one called Plymouth. And this is how England and the Dutch, with the Dutch East and West India companies and some of that, that's how they paid for a lot of their colonization, y'all. And it was a cheap way for England to do it. England made money off of it if it was successful by taxes or whatever. But if it failed, England wasn't really out anything. The only really negative advantage of this I can see, y'all, is it does put a lot of pressure on the colonists. The people in Jamestown, the people in Plymouth, y'all, were constantly under pressure to make their colony pay. People back in England had invested money in them. They had trusted them to be successful. And so they felt like they had to do that. So remember, joint stock company, today's modern corporation, it was a way, y'all, to basically to finance the Dutch and especially the English colonies, okay? And a cheap way for them to do it. That is really it.